It's Cybersecurity Awareness Month, and OWASP recently announced that they're collecting data for the OWASP Top 10 2025. This could have a significant impact on developer awareness of web app security risks, and I have some strong opinions about it. For those of you who don't know, OWASP is the Open World Application Security Project, and the OWASP Top 10 is a list of the most critical security risks to web applications. The intention of the top 10 is to raise awareness of the worst security issues, with a specific focus on how developers can both fix and avoid these issues when coding. The OWASP Top 10 is often used as a baseline for web security, and a new version is only released every 4 years, which makes accuracy even more important. If you're new here, welcome to my channel. I'm Tiberius, I've been a web app pen tester for over a decade, and I've been pretty vocal about my opposition to the OWASP Top 10 for a while, especially on my streams. The other day, I was discussing some of the OWASP Top 10 stuff with Tanya, aka SheHacksPurple, and I felt like it was about time I expressed my thoughts in a single video. I don't expect anything to come of this video, and admittedly, one of my criticisms is pretty minor and mostly semantic. In any case, these are the problems I see with the OWASP Top 10 and what can be done to fix them. If you enjoy the video, please consider giving it a like, subscribing to the channel, and leaving a comment to let me know what you think. Let's get the more semantic stuff out of the way first. The name just doesn't make sense anymore. To be fair to OWASP, this is a result of the way the Top 10 has evolved over the years. Back in 2007, they described the project as the 10 most critical web application security vulnerabilities, and the list contained individual vulnerabilities, things like cross-site scripting, IDOR, cross-site request forgery, as well as some broader categories of vulnerability like injection. What has happened since is the broader categories have gradually taken over the top 10. In the 2013 version, insecure cryptographic storage was merged with insufficient transport layer protection to form the sensitive data exposure category. In 2017, IDOR and missing function level access control were merged into broken access control. At the same time, the project description was changed from the 10 most critical web application security vulnerabilities to the 10 most critical web application security risks. The focus had moved from individual vulnerabilities, which made sense given the increased use of categorization. So, why is this a problem? Well, as of the latest 2021 release, there is only one individual vulnerability left on the OWASP Top 10, server-side request forgery. Everything else is a broad category, covering a large number of individual flaws. For example, the broken access control category is mapped to 34 CWEs. With so many broad categories, what exactly is top about the top 10 anymore? Remember, this is supposed to be a list of the 10 most critical web application security risks. Calling it the top 10 implies there are more than 10 risks, and in fact, the release document for the OWASP Top 10 2013 even included a warning, "Don't stop at 10." However, I would argue that the top 10 as it stands today covers most risks posed to web applications. I can't remember a time in the last 8 years, in fact, when I wasn't required to match a vulnerability I found in a pen test to an OWASP Top 10 category in a report. And for the most part, it wasn't hard. It got even easier in 2021 when the insecure design category was introduced. Regardless of the intentions behind this category, it functioned as a catch-all for anything that didn't fit perfectly into another. What started out as an awareness project for some of the worst security issues affecting web apps has turned into a relatively comprehensive document that covers a huge range of security issues, spanning all severity levels. Whatever it is, it's not a top 10. But hey, you could convince me that in the world of marketing, words are flexible and the name holds enough weight that changing it would be a stupid move. Like I said, this was mostly arguing semantics. Let's read the description of the project from the official website though. The OWASP Top 10 is a standard awareness document for developers and web application security. It represents a broad consensus about the most critical security risks to web applications. Does it? Really? the most critical security risks? It's a top 10, so logically it's ordered, and this is confirmed by the fact that every time they release one, the ordering changes. Some items go up, some go down, some stay in place. If it's a list of the most critical security risks, that means the items at the top of the list are the most critical, right? But that's not how the list works at all. Broken access control is in first place, and while I agree it can be bad, is it really more severe than an SQL injection or a command injection? Even worse, in second place and also above the injection category are cryptographic failures. Server-side request forgery, the lone individual vulnerability on the current OWASP top 10, is in 10th place. Last. A vulnerability that can access and often exfiltrate data from backend systems is, according to the OWASP top 10, the least risky item on the list. It just doesn't make any sense, until you read how they actually generate the list. OWASP collect data in two ways. They ask organizations like pen testing companies, vulnerability scanning companies, bug bounty platforms, etc., to submit statistics on the vulnerabilities they found over the past 4 years. That data forms 8 of the 10 risks in the top 10. The other two come from an industry survey, which, quote, allows the practitioners on the front lines to vote for what they see as the highest risks that might not be represented in the data. After the data is collected and the vulnerability stats have been categorized, OWASP select the 8 categories with the highest incidence rates. By incidence rate, they mean what percentage of applications had at least one instance of a vulnerability type. In other words, they're looking at which categories are most commonly occurring across applications in general. What's the problem? The most common risks are not necessarily the most critical risks. In fact, in many cases, the opposite is likely true. The OWASP top 10 claims to be a list of the most critical security risks. It is not. It is, after all this, a list of the most commonly occurring risks to applications, which I feel is just not that useful. Certainly, if a vulnerability has both a high severity and commonly occurs, that's worth being aware of, but a vulnerability that commonly occurs at a low severity should likely not appear on a top 10 of the most critical security risks. A fairly decent way of calculating risk, especially when you don't have much contextual information, is to multiply the severity by the likelihood of exploitation. A critical severity vulnerability that is practically impossible to exploit is not going to pose a huge risk to the application. Meanwhile, a high or even medium severity vulnerability that can be exploited with ease should be considered more of a risk. Remember the second place category on the list, cryptographic failures? It covers a substantial number of vulnerabilities, from data being transmitted over clear text to side channel attacks against TLS. There are arguably some critical severity vulnerabilities in the category, but are they exploitable? Probably not. I'd wager the reason cryptographic failures is so high on the list is because it's easy to find slightly misconfigured TLS servers, and even easier to report them. Nessus and Nmap can both flag so-called weak ciphers, which are rated as low severity, because they usually require nation-state level computing power to break. I find such ciphers enabled on almost all tests I perform, and I bet others do too. So I guess ironically, we're all partially to blame for the OWASP top 10 ranking cryptographic failures as the second most critical security risk. The OWASP top 10 is supposed to be an awareness document for developers, but by ignoring risk and focusing more on frequency, I think it's failing to make developers aware of the actual risks to web applications. So how do we fix it? Well, in my opinion, the data collection and data processing needs a huge rethink, and some context needs to be added to adjust the results. Currently, the data collection does nothing to measure the risk posed to applications, which seems odd for data supposedly being collected to compile a list of the most critical security risks. OWASP should be ensuring that the data they collect includes something like a CVSS score for each vulnerability being submitted. And I know, CVSS sucks, but it's better than nothing at all. CVSS already attempts to combine severity and likelihood by measuring the actual requirements for a successful exploit. Where the attacker needs to be on the network, what user level they need, etc. along with what a successful exploit can lead to in terms of loss of confidentiality, integrity, and availability. If OWASP were to track these, then it would help to decide where a category ranks in terms of risk, as opposed to just how common it is. I highly suspect if this is performed, we would see cryptographic issues plummet to the bottom of the list, and injection vulnerabilities would battle it out with broken access control for the top spot. OWASP could then use this new data to generate separate lists, showing things like the most severe issues, the most common issues, and more, which may be useful stats to evaluate generally. I'm not holding out hope myself, especially as the data collection period has started, but there's also no reason why OWASP should be the only organization making a list like the top 10. With the speed at which web technologies develop, such a list could arguably benefit from being an annual endeavor, rather than one which only happens every 4 years. LLMs like ChatGPT have only been public for 2 years, with prompt injection attacks only becoming major areas of concern in the last one. Arguably, LLM attacks could feature on the top 10, but will there be enough data to show that, or will we have to rely on the industry survey? What do you think about the OWASP top 10 and the process they use to generate it? Are there any changes you'd like to see, or do you think my complaints are invalid? Let me know in the comments either way. If you've enjoyed watching this video, even if you disagree with me, please consider giving it a like and subscribing to the channel. I'll see you next time.